Okay, I think we can start. So this webinar will be dedicated to Gilles Herriard Dubreuil, who just passed away. He was the secretary and co-founder of NTW. Many of you know have known him. And he was really involved in bringing a civil society expertise in different topic, including radioactive waste management. So this webinar series continue. We have on the same ground that I will recall quickly than before, which are coming from an evaluation from NTW on the application of transparency and public participation in the development of national radioactive waste programs with several national case studies on early stage and advanced programs with both large and small inventories. The assessment overview of good and bad example was based on criteria of the Aarhus Convention and BEPPER report, a report from NTW. And we hope that this second case study will on Denmark will allow information and exchanges among civil society members to help broaden understanding and views. So just a quick recall of the calendar we have. So we had a presentation in January by the chair of NTW, Nadia Zeleznik, on the general frame of this webinar series. Then we had the first presentation from Johan Swan on the national case of Sweden. And today we have the presentation of the Danish national case by Niels Henrik Hooge. And in conclusion, I will recall that Nuclear Transparency Watch encourages and supports citizens to seek national legal remedy or communicate on violation if that occurs, and work on the governance issues in relation to radioactive waste management, such as public participation, long-term governance, or intergenerational issues. So if you have practical questions, you may ask them. Otherwise, on the content of the presentation, you will be able to ask a question dedicated at the end of the presentation of Niels, which will start now.
Thank you, Malcolm. And I just want to say that I think all our thoughts go to Jill and his family in this terrible situation. So the subject of my presentation is transparency and public participation in Danish radioactive waste management. And I should say that to a large degree, this presentation touches upon a lot of the same subjects that is touched upon in a civil society report in the EWAD project that relates to waste management rules from cradle to grave. The report has not been published yet, but I guess that it will happen very soon. So I must admit I have a lot of slides, so I will try to go through them very quickly. Regarding the content of the presentation, I would say that its focus is on how a new concept for the Danish final radioactive waste disposal was reached in 2018, and a short chronology of how it happened. One could argue that this actually was a rather dramatic and perhaps a very interesting chain of events. It also demonstrates how it is in fact possible for civil society to influence the decision-making process in a positive way. Finally, I will try to describe five lessons to take away from this presentation that might be of general interest. So the starting point is that there is no or has been any Danish nuclear power program. There was plans for a program, but they were abandoned in 1985 due to a lot of public pressure. So the reactors that are now decommissioned are research reactors at the Risø National Laboratory. On the slide, you also see, and I think many of you will recognize it, it's the smiling sun, the world famous symbol of the Danish nuclear power opposition that since has developed into a global symbol. Hooge information on nuclear power dissolved itself as a popular movement in 1999 and has until recently existed as a foundation. So one could argue that Denmark is a typical small inventory member state, of which there currently exist seven or eight in Europe. We have almost 10,000 cubic meters of low and intermediate level radioactive waste. Most of it originates from these Risø research reactors, but there's also waste from hospitals, industry, and research institutions, but not very much. It should also be mentioned that we have 203 kilos of high-level nuclear waste, which are fragments of spent fuel. So the issues here are, I would say, four. The first one would be that the initial concept for a final repository for the low and intermediate level nuclear waste did not meet international accepted safety requirements. At that time, there were little or no public confidence in the authorities' ability to find a viable long-term solution. And this was not least due to the deficiencies in the documentation presented to the public and how the radioactive waste was classified, which led to the wrong choice of repository types. And we also had some very serious procedural issues due to lack of transparency and public participation. The good news is that most of these problems have now been resolved, and in the following I will try to explain how. So if you take a look at the initial radioactive waste repository concept, which was proposed in 2011, it was a near surface final repository that was conceived in combination with a borehole possibly a medium deep disposal at up to 100 meters of depth. The planned administratively controllable period was 300 to 500 years to below clearance levels, and the repository was foreseen to be completed actually this year. But in 2018, 70 years later, all this changed. All the political parties in the Danish parliament adopted a new proposal on the future of radioactive waste management. According to this decision, the low and intermediate level radioactive waste will be temporarily stored until 2073, 50 years from now, at the latest in an upgraded interim storage facility at Risø National Laboratory, and then permanently disposed of in a deep geological repository approximately 500 meters below surface. This means that the previous final repository site selection has to be repeated from scratch. And furthermore, the option of transnational cooperation is kept open, and involvement of stakeholders will continue in a contact forum for the radioactive waste. So the obvious question, how did that happen? And here you have to look at the decision-making process in its entirety, its turning points, and the development developments of the procedure. So there are some significant dates, and I will go through the chronology as quick as I can. First, we have back to 2003, where the Parliament gives its consent to prepare a basis for decision on a final repository for the waste. The same year, Danish decommissioning is established under the purview of the Ministry of Science, Technology and Innovation as a waste management organization. Danish decommissioning is responsible for the decommissioning of the nuclear facilities. So the next year, next 6 years, not much happens. But in 2009, a basis for decision is presented to the Parliament that describes the safety and environmental principles for the final repository and outlines three preliminary parallel studies to be carried out prior to the establishment of the repository. 2 years later, the findings and recommendations of the three studies are presented. 22 possible repository locations are mentioned, and six are recommended in five different municipalities. More comprehensive field studies will then lead to a further reduction of the number of designated sites to two or three. However, and this is important, all the five municipalities refuse to host the repository. They are dissatisfied that they have not been told in advance and had to hear of Danish decommissioning's recommendations through the press. Unfortunately, their protests are ignored. So in 2012, citizens groups against nuclear waste are founded in all the five municipalities, and these are big citizens groups, which typically has hundreds of members. They also organize a public hearing in Copenhagen. They couldn't get it into the parliament, but they have it nearby, and it is organized by the host municipalities. Almost 55,000 signatures against the final repository are handed over to the minister. The same year, this is also interesting, representatives of the citizen groups visit Kovra's interim storage facility in the Netherlands, and also that the mayors from the five municipalities write to all the members of the Danish parliament, among others, calling them to choose an interim storage facility for the nuclear waste. So as a result of this exportation of the radioactive waste now becomes a political option, according to the responsible ministry. The next turning point, I would say, is by the end of 2012, when international experts indicate that the Danish concept for a final repository is unfeasible. It is heavily criticized by Johan Svan, whom we have here at this webinar, and who's director of the Swedish NGO Office for Nuclear Waste Review. Erling Stranden, the former director of the Norwegian Radiation Protection Authority and former chairman of the committee responsible for the Norwegian radioactive waste management, and Leonard Johansson, a member of the Swedish National Council for Nuclear Waste that advises the Swedish government on nuclear-related matters. This is a criticism, in fact, from international recognized expert in the field. So the five citizens groups call on the Danish parliament to set up a radioactive waste commission. And a couple of later, this leads to that the decision on the final radioactive waste repository is in fact postponed. At the beginning of 2013, the Minister of Health informs the Parliament on the future process for the site selection. The number of designated sites will be reduced from 6 to 2 when the strategic environmental assessment is completed. An agreement is reached that the Ministry of Health must investigate if all the waste can be exported or if it can be placed in an interim storage facility. This means that there are now three different options for the radioactive waste management, and not only the one a final repository that was decided on 10 years before. The same year, and I think this is also a significant development, the Council of the Central Denmark Region rejects the concept for a final radioactive waste repository. And also the schedule for the upcoming strategic environmental assessment of the designated sites is public. But this turns out to be delayed for more than a year. So the mayors of the municipalities actually decide to cooperate in a formal way and in fact publish an agreement how to do it. They also ask for a more transparent decision making process. And the establishment of a nuclear commission, just like the citizens groups did. And then the strategic environmental assessment of the plan for the final repository begins. And again, more criticism of the final repository concept, this time by the associations of waterworks in Denmark, which is an interest organization for private consumer-owned waterworks that supply water for approximately 2 million consumers. And the organization represents 2,000 of Denmark's 2,500 private-owned waterworks. And now, this is perhaps one of the real major turning points in the chronology of the Danish radioactive waste management process, because the German Öko-Institut, which is one of the world leading expert organizations in the field of radioactive waste management, publishes a working paper analyzing the Danish final repository project. Among others, the institute concludes that none of the Danish radioactive waste from Risø National laboratory decays within the administratively controllable period of less than 300 years to below clearance level. So none of it is suitable for the plant near surface disposal. According to Eco-Institute, the only two of the Danish waste types decay enough within the time period to the next predicted ice age to below clearance levels. One is slightly above that criterion, whereas all the other 18 waste types require confinement times of 100,000 years or more. What the Eco-Institute in fact says is that the classification of the Danish nuclear waste, which has been so far been classified as short-lived, is in fact long-lived. So a near surface repository is not an option. So the Danish method to evaluate the feasibility of the disposal, according to Eco-Institute, is unsound from a safety standpoint because it ignores the basic principles of safe geological disposal. The criteria that should have been applied should have been to identify geological layers 300 to 800 meters below surface with a geological predictable long-term integrity. Therefore, the results, according to Eco-Institute, of the performed site selection process are useless. The conclusion is that the ongoing process to locate the final repository in one of the five designated municipalities should not be continued before clear and appropriate safety criteria for the repository have been established. It turns out that this is not an isolated criticism by just one sink tank. Early the next year, the criticism of Eco-Institute is repeated during the strategic environmental assessment. In a long series of position papers from, among others, nuclear authorities in Sweden, Germany, and Poland. And this brings the Minister of Health, backed by all the political parties, to decide further to investigate whether it is possible to build an interim storage facility for the radioactive waste at the Risø National Laboratory. And the findings of this investigation will be presented after a year. Again, following the same track, six NGOs organized an international conference at the Danish Parliament building, Christiansborg, on the viability of the Danish final repository contract concept. Among the lecturers are some of these recognized experts who have criticized the Danish final disposal concept in the past. The conference documents that the initial Danish final repository is fundamentally flawed, does not live up to international safety standards, and that the site selection process should start all over again. Also, and I think this is also rather important because that clearly demonstrates the possible what impact an active civil society could have on the radioactive waste management process. The six NGOs organizing the conference recommend establishment of a broadly composed contact forum with the participation of the organizations and authorities responsible for the management and disposal of the radioactive waste. Also with the representatives of civil society, including NGOs and citizens groups, affected local and regional authorities, independent international experts, organizations, and relevant nuclear authorities from neighboring countries. The forum, which should be integrated into the radioactive waste management decision-making process, should meet up regularly. I should mention that a somewhat similar but more limited concept has been floated around by the authorities in the past without being realized. After the Danish general election the same year, political responsibility for radioactive waste management is transferred from the Ministry of Health to the Ministry of Higher Education and Science. As some of its first measures, the ministry establishes exactly this national contact forum for radioactive waste. It has approximately 20 members, and any representative can bring anything to the agenda for future meetings, and also the minutes are public. So basically, you have all the stakeholders in the same room at the same time, forcing them to address each other's concerns. Affiliated with the contact forum is a panel of scholars from Danish universities to give answers to questions from the general public. The panel members are selected by the Danish Council for Independent Research, which provides independent scientific counseling to the Danish government. In the context of radioactive waste management, the expert panel submits written answers to questions on nuclear physics and nuclear energy, health physics and radiation protection, environmental impact assessment and environmental law, public governance and general ethics. A deadline for the answers is normally 2 weeks. So in fact, the Danish government has here provided the public with access to second opinions on any vital issue related to radioactive waste management. And I think this is a very important measure for sure. Furthermore, Danish decommissioning founds an international evaluation group that follows and comments on the radioactive waste management process. So in May 2016, almost 7 years ago, we have the first meeting of the Ministry of Higher Education and Science, a national contact forum for radioactive waste. Here you have the picture actually from the first meeting taken in the courtyard of the ministry. Since then, there has been 11 meetings. So the next turning point is in March 2018, when the Minister for Higher Education and Science put forward a proposal for a parliamentary decision on a long-term solution for Denmark's radioactive waste. The proposal, which is supported by all the political parties, indicates that the low and intermediate level radioactive waste will be temporarily stored until 2073 at the latest in an upgraded interim storage facility, and afterwards permanently disposed of in a deep geological repository. This also means that the site selection procedure has to be repeated from scratch. Furthermore, the option of transnational cooperation is kept open, and involvement of stakeholders is determined to continue in a contact forum for radioactive waste. And this proposal is adopted by all members of the Danish parliament a couple of months later. And it has also been viewed as a big victory from for the green movement in Denmark, who has pleaded for this for many years. So the next year there is yet another contact forum. This time in Roskilde municipality, where you have Risø National Laboratory that is supposed to build this interim, where you have this interim storage facility. So this local contact forum is designated to follow the construction and the operation of this interim storage facility closely. And even more local contact fora are expected when the two potential host sites for the deep geological repository are found. So far, Roskilde Municipality's contact forum has had 17 meetings, and they are typically held in Roskilde Municipality's town hall. The next turning point would be 3 years later, January last year, when GEOS, and that would be the Geological Survey of Denmark and Greenland, publishes 9 reports on the geology of Denmark at 500 meters depth, facilitating a new phase in the siting selection for the final repository, which is expected to end up with two possible host sites before the designation of the final location. So GEOS has actually looked at the entire Danish subsurface based on a number of criteria for the properties of the subsoil in regard to deep geological deposition based on the requirements of the Danish Parliament, international guidelines from the EIA, OECD, and EU directives, as well as experiences from similar projects in Switzerland, Sweden, Finland, England, France, and Belgium. So they have really looked around in order to facilitate this project. The international experts have also been involved in defining the criteria and the concept for the evaluation of the Danish areas. So GEOS in fact concludes that there are large areas in Denmark where further investigations are expected to identify sites with favorable geological characteristics and meet the established requirements. Here you have some of the criteria related to safety and technical feasibility to be evaluated through the geological siting process. I will not elaborate more on them. Also, Denmark has been divided into 11 areas, each with a characteristic geologic and a certain structure, and these areas have then been evaluated according to the criteria. Some of the areas seem to be very suitable for a geological disposal and others don't, but I won't go into that. So in conclusion, with regard to implementation of the Aarhus Convention, which is I guess the main subject of this presentation would be that I think that the Danish, you can conclude from what has been said here, that the Danish level of implementation of the Aarhus Convention must be high. The slide here shows the legal basis for its implementation, and I think I will just skip that. There's also a national policy in place on public participation decision making, and it is supported by information dissemination on various websites. First and foremost, on the Ministry of Higher Education and Science, where you actually can find most of the information that I have given here. It is supplemented by the website of Danish decommissioning, which is also very transparent, and the Danish Health Authority. And obviously, you have all the public hearings and the facilitation of stakeholder dialogue through the aforementioned contact forum. So just to repeat, effective access for civil society to transparency and public participation in regard to the Aarhus Convention has been soundly established here in Denmark. Furthermore, in regard to justice, or rather access to justice, which is also one of the pillars of the Aarhus Convention, it is so far further supported by a de facto municipality veto in the final radioactive waste repository site selection, because so far there has been no intention of forcing any municipality to accept a final repository if the municipality is unwilling to do so. So to bring my presentation to an end, I think there are five lessons to take away from what I have said here. The first would be that in order to manage and dispose of radioactive waste with the proper speed, the necessary time has to be invested. Reservations and objections from stakeholders must be addressed until all problems are solved. The inclusion of civil society must be so thorough and credible that it ensures that all future decisions fully meet the public's need for information and participation, and guarantees that the political choices not only are socially, culturally, politically, and economically viable, but also technologically acceptable and sound. The second lesson would be that criticism of the decision-making process and the final repository concept has indeed worked, at least in Denmark. And this could not have happened without a strong implementation of the Aarhus and the ESPO conventions, manifesting itself in a comprehensive strategic environmental assessment. A time out was in fact applied as a result of the pressure from the affected local communities and criticism from the NGOs, international experts and authorities in the neighboring countries. And during this timeout, the regulators and the political decision makers took the necessary time to reflect and had the courage to fundamentally change the course of that initially was plotted. The third lesson would be that the criticism should, if not be institutionalized, then at least integrated in the decision-making process. Because the best possible standards relate not only to goals, but also to means, including the best and most inclusive and democratic practices. The improvements were not the least due to the establishment of a national contact forum for radioactive waste, followed by a regional contact forum with potentially more fora to follow. Since the establishment of the fora, the dialogue with the civil society has been much more constructive. The fourth lesson would be that criticism should be supported by sufficient resources. And here I do not only think of financial means, but also knowledge and capacity building, experience, available time, etc. Although government funding has not been allocated to NGOs, like, for instance, in Sweden, I know that this unfortunately will stop now. Sufficient resources have been allocated in Denmark to the preservation and development of the institutional mechanisms that ensure stakeholder involvement and access for the public to a second opinion on any radioactive waste management decision from the independent expert panel that is affiliated with the contact forum. And the fifth and final lesson would be that the decision-making process is not over yet in Denmark before the radioactive waste is permanently disposed of. It must be expected that the new and presumably safer repository concept potentially could be met with some of the same local opposition as the former repository concept sometime in the future. Nonetheless, the lessons that in the meantime have been learned might make these final steps easier and not least make for a better outcome. Thank you. This was my presentation. And if you have any questions, I would be happy to try to answer them.
Thank you very much, Niels. There is already a question in the chat from Jan. So I can read it for you if you want.
Yes, please.
So Jan is asking, would you say that this high level of public participation has led to delays or rather improving the quality of where we are now? First question.
Yes, because all the stakeholders, including civil society, has a full overview of any development in the Danish radioactive waste management process. And there has been a lot of trust building. Actually, when you put the 20 people together in one room for a lot of meetings over several years, and they started all this by fighting, and I can say the fighting in Denmark was intense. If you put them together in one room, at some point of time, they will actually start a real dialogue and build a lot of trust. And with trust follows openness and also honesty. So I wouldn't say that building, for instance, an interim storage facility or final disposal is a collective effort or collective project, but there is a lot of mutual recognition and actually understanding of the necessity to involve civil society. So I think at least for small inventory member states, the Danish model could indeed be a very good model to follow, perhaps with the modifications dependent which nation you talk about and how big the amount of radioactive waste and its composition, etc. But I think the Danish model has proven its value.
So do you think it can be transferred to a larger nuclear program?
Yeah, that the problem is that the lines are much clear drawn in the big countries such as Germany and France and what have you. And I mean, the confrontation has reached another level. But I know that at least in Germany, there are some of the same developments. But I cannot say in all honesty that this model would function in a large inventory member states. But for the small inventory member states, definitely.
Okay, unless Jan wants to react on this, we have Gabby asking about the de facto municipality veto. What do you mean about it?
Yeah, there's no formal, there's no legislation in place, but for political reasons, I think no Danish government, at least not for the time being, would force a final repository on any municipality, because the mayors in all of the municipalities emerge from the two competing government parties. And they have a direct line to the relevant ministries, so it cannot be. For political reasons, it's unfeasible.
May I add a second question? And is there any legislation planned to establish a veto?
No. It's so far into the future, and there actually were plans to force the site selection or to speed up the site selection process, but I think all the political parties and all the shifting governments consider this a really loser case. 20 years ago, there was actually among the different ministries a competition in order not to be responsible for the radioactive waste management, because it was considered so politically toxic that nobody wants to touch it, and the loser, not the winner, became the Ministry of Health, and they accepted it very reluctantly. And it has turned out to be a loser case for the political parties, but not to the same degree now, because there's a consensus that this is the right model.
Does having an interim storage until 2074 not lead to other authorities pushing decisions backwards instead of taking responsibility now?
Well, the thing is, when you build and invest a big amount of money in an interim storage facility and build it to last up to 100 years at least, then there's an expectation that it will actually be used. Otherwise, it would be a waste of money. So I think the waste will be there probably until 2073, where it is formally, which is the formal deadline. But I mean, the most significant new development has been that GEOS, as the geological survey for Denmark and Greenland, has determined that a lot more municipalities than the initial five are suitable for final geological disposal. So I could expect that the political criteria, where they accept to receive the for political reasons, would be the determining factor in the site selection process. But obviously, nobody knows. So now the sound disappeared.
Yeah. In addition to the geological criteria, are there also social, socioeconomic, and the environmental criteria for site selection defined in Denmark?
Yes, no, they so far they have only looked at the geological to be blunt, I think they will put it where in a municipality that accepts it. Obviously, it has to fulfill the criteria, but they are now, I wouldn't say watered down, but broader in scope. But again, I mean, who can predict what happens in 50 years from now? But I view it as unlikely based on the enormous resistance from municipalities in the past that the site selection process will be speeded up, because there's no political interest in that. This is a really loser case by political definition.
That's all for now for the questions. We have 5 minutes left. If you have still questions or remarks, please feel free.
Yeah, we have yet another one guest from Noah, who has also participated in this. And I would say that Johan Swan has also been active. Palle, if you have any additional comments, feel free to supplement.
No, unfortunately, I could only join 10 minutes ago. So.
No, okay, yeah. But I think you will agree that there will be no selection of a final repository site in the near future. I mean, that is definitely something for the future.
Yeah, that seems obvious.
Yeah.
May I? Yeah. Hi, Nadia here. I was looking for the hand to raise. Now I manage. I would like to say thank you very much, Niels, because this was a really very good case where, you know, political representative managed to understand the requirements, and then they really flexibly changed the process according to the requirements from the civil society, NGOs and others. What I would like to say is your final 5 lesson learned. Do you think it's they have a more general value? I would say so, but what is your opinion?
To understand your question, you're thinking of the Danish radioactive waste management process, whether the lessons could have a general value. Yeah, I think so, but mostly for small inventory member states. And I think why we succeeded, because typically in the small inventory member states, the green NGOs do not have much expertise in the nuclear field, because there is no nuclear. There are no nuclear power plants. So we have to rely on advice and guidance from our colleagues in other countries. And fortunately, we had in Denmark, we had Sweden and Johan Svan his think tank. And he aided us and not only by the advice he gave of himself, but he also opened up access for us to his whole international network. So I would say without Johan, there would not be all these turning points in the Danish radioactive waste management process. So for the small inventory member states and civil society, it comes down to international networks. And that's why Nuclear Transparency Watch is also important in this regard, because it is an international network of NGOs and experts.
Maybe, Johan, you want to react on this and also raise your question? And after, there will be a question from Saif, and I think we'll close the meeting.
Yeah, I would just have a comment on this. First of all, it was very interesting to work together with Niels Henrik and others in Denmark. And I think we can generally say that it was quite successful, the work that we did. I think that one of the critical things that made a difference, I think, was that the idea of having a new temporary storage facility, it allowed somehow a decision to do something, which was to build a place where they could, you know, repackage. It can be more, you know, the inventory can be more classified and so on. So they had a decision to do something while still then having the long-term discussion going on and the continued work on that. So I think that was quite kind of an interesting thing that I think turned a bit politically when that came up. I don't know if Ms. Henrik agrees with this or, but that was my perception.
Yes, I do. Yeah, I definitely agree. And thank you for your comment.
So, Saif, maybe you want to raise your question?
Yeah.
This was a mistake. You. Okay, sorry.
Yeah. So, yeah, very quickly. So, good morning, everyone. Thank you, Niels, for this very interesting presentation. I think it's one of the first ones I've ever seen on the Danish program. Maybe I should have introduced myself. Saif Benajasin, I work for the European Commission on the research and innovation part. And I, among my duties, I also manage the EURAD program. I'm the program officer. And I just wanted to react because we struggle sometimes to reach out to these small inventory or early stage programs in the EU, and they would benefit greatly from the EURAD program. So my question is not really a question, but mostly an invitation to the Danish representatives or institutes to be part of the EURAD program so that they can benefit from the expertise that we have in the other EU member states. And about that, we will be having this annual event next week in Cyprus, another small inventory country in early stage program. But you can register and access to all of these sessions online directly. And there will be a session dedicated to the small inventory countries. So when I was seeing all of the slides and everything, I was thinking, but this could have been way faster if they had the feedback and the expertise from the other member states and from the advanced countries. So I will maybe copy paste the link to register to the annual event. The deadline is today or tomorrow, I'm not entirely sure. If you wish to follow up remotely, you have to register. Please do so if it's interesting to you. I would honestly be very glad if we had the Danish with us for the next partnership. Yeah.
Saif, the Danish decommissioning is actually involved quite a lot in the roots work package.
But they're not.
So they're already in there in a certain. Yeah.
Are they mandated? Are they a mandated actor?
Because I think so. Yes. So you have a Danish participation.
Sorry, my bad. Yeah, because I was checking the list and I didn't see them. So
I even think that Ole Kasper is giving a presentation. He's the head of the Danish decommissioning.
Okay, that's good. Okay, so maybe I didn't have the last list because I was checking the list immediately right now. And sorry for that then. And that was my comment. Yeah. And again,
but it's still good to have the link because some will be there physically, other will be online, some are not informed. So please register if you're interested to know more about the work done in ERAD.
Okay, great. Well, in any case, thank you again, NTB, for organizing these webinars. Very informative ones. Yeah.
And thank you all for participating. And it's great. We will meet next time about to discuss about the case of the French case, so a larger inventory, and the one after would be on Greenland. So Niels, again. So, and with that, have a very good afternoon and lunch break. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye.